We'll talk about deep learned supersampling. So yeah, it's got a fancy name.
Cool name.
It sounds cool. It's quite cool. Let's imagine that you're running a game, right? I don't do that as often as I'd like anymore. But maybe you're pushing your graphics card right to the limit of where it's happy, right? You've got a 4K monitor. You're pushing a lot of pixels to the screen. The game is a big game with lots of effects. The problem is that then your frame rate's going to start suffering. So maybe what we could do is run at a lower frame rate, which is going to be that much easier for your graphics card, and then use deep learning to recreate that 4K image. And if the deep learning is good enough, you won't be able to tell the difference. So the most recent generation of NVIDIA graphics cards have these Tensor Cores on board, right? Tensor Cores are basically very quick matrix multiplication circuitry. Matrix multiplication comes up a lot in deep learning, which is kind of what these were designed around, but it has some applications to games, a little bit. I'm gonna betray my lack of knowledge about modern games, right? I don't really know much about them. I play some games, but very easy ones. So I'm not running games at 4K and worrying about frame rates, right? But some people do concern themselves with these things, and they spend a lot of money on these graphics cards, and they want them to run as well as they can. The problem is that maybe some game comes out and it has a huge demand on your GPU, right? For every pixel in your game, the GPU's got to work out which triangles in the world it needs to, you know, it needs to render, what color they're going to be. It's got to include lighting and shadows, you know, blurs and, you know, depth of field effects, like I was talking about last video. You know, this takes a long time, and the more pixels you use, the worse it gets.
And motion blur, of course.
And motion blur. I know people love motion blur. I myself can't get enough of it. What do you do about this? One thing you do is you just make your graphics cards faster, right? And this is something that happens every generation, not just on NVIDIA cards, but, you know, all graphics cards. And that helps a lot, right? But the problem is we've had a jump from 1080p to 4K, and that is not a slight increase in number of pixels. It's four times the number of pixels, which on a simple level means four times the amount of work, right, to render this screen. And you've got to also, when we talk about things like super sampling, sometimes we're looking at a pixel more than once, right? And that means it's getting really slow. So what NVIDIA have tried to do here is say, well, maybe we can save quite a lot of performance by, let's say, running our game at 1080p, right? But if you upsample that to 4K, maybe it won't look very good, because basically it's just going to be blurred. So maybe we could do a slightly smarter upsampling using these sort of deep learned super resolution techniques.
As I understand it, even modern TVs these days do scaling, and they scale things up, and Blu-ray recorders, DVD recorders have always, you know, had an element of doing this scaling. Yeah. Is this just a more advanced version of that?
Yeah, and some TVs are starting to bring in, as far as I know, deep learned, you know, smart AI driven upsampling, right? The idea is that, so what happens when you run a game is you're adding all these effects on top of one another to get a good performance. Now, if your frame rate starts to drop, what you're going to do probably is either drop your resolution, or if you don't want to drop your resolution because you don't like it, you start to remove some of the effects, right? So you drop your shaders down from high to something else, and that will just reduce the amount of work per pixel and just slightly increase your frame rate. But some people don't want to do this, right? They spent a lot of money on their computer and they want to run it on full graphics. But maybe a game has come out that's just really, really demanding. There's kind of two problems we want to solve here. One is this problem of aliasing, right? Which is that if you rasterize a scene with triangles, they don't always line up exactly where the pixels are, so you get a kind of jagged edge, right? That's one problem, which doesn't look very nice, and there are techniques to get around this. The other problem is this issue of resolution, right? If you drop down from 4K to 1080p, your game runs, you know, could run four times faster. That's a huge benefit, right? If you could do that without noticing any difference in appearance, well, that's a winner, right? That's going to be great. And then you can start putting in even more computational time on shader effects and things, so that, yes, you're running at a lower resolution, but those pixels have had a good deal of time spent on them. They look really nice. One of the problems we have is this problem called aliasing, right? Now, I'm going to just talk about this very briefly because it's not really what this video is about. But if you're rendering an image and your triangle falls like this, then this pixel actually isn't all of this object here. Maybe this object is dark and this object is light. It's not all of this object. It's like 70% dark and 30% light. Now, the problem is that there's no way of doing this. So if you sample this pixel here, and this pixel here, you're going to get an edge that goes light, dark, light, like this, right? And that looks ugly. So what you'd use is a technique usually called something multi-sample anti-aliasing, where essentially you take multiple readings from this pixel, like these four here, or something more dense than that, And there's lots of different ways to do this. And then you average those values. And the nice thing is then you've got three readings of dark, one reading of light, and you come out with a reading of about 75% dark, and you get a smooth edge. This is one thing that graphics cards do to try and make things look a little bit better. If you turn off all these anti-aliasing approaches, then what you'll get is your core jaggedy lines. It'll run nice and quickly. If you're sampling four times per pixel, that could be a fourfold decrease in speed, right? And that has a performance hit, right? Unless your graphics card is just amazing. Mine is not. That's one problem, right? The other problem is that, you know, when you go up to 4K, it's just four times the number of pixels. Whatever you're doing per pixel is multiplied by four. It's four times the amount of pixels. That, you know, that's a huge problem. So if you're running 4K and four samples, for example, per pixel, that's a lot more computation than if you were just running without anti-aliasing on 1080p, right? And so you inevitably have to drop down some of these settings so that you can get a good frame rate for your game, and it doesn't look as nice. So one option is just to make the graphics cards faster, right? This can't always, you know, this isn't the answer to everything, and they get more and more expensive, right? That's also a problem. These new cards have in them these tensor cores, which are very good at specific operations, namely matrix multiplications. And so there is a chance that what we could do is use a deep network to kind of just clean this image up for us very quickly before it's presented to the screen. And that will give us a nice presentation for our image without the huge performance hit of doing all of this anti-aliasing and all of this massive resolution, right? So, but broadly speaking, it works like this. Your computer will render a raw frame with aliasing and all the kind of problems that it has. And this may or may not be at the same resolution as your monitor. It will then be passed through a deep network, which is not very deep because this has got to happen pretty quickly, which utilizes the tensor cores of these new graphics cards to work very, very quickly. And that will produce your nice 4K with anti-aliasing shot, which theoretically looks really, really nice. The way they train this network, when they take the lower resolution aliased version and the higher resolution anti-aliased version, is they're going to train it basically to try and create the image on a pixel level as closely as possible. But they'll also add additional parameters like that it looks perceptually nice, right? So there's these perceptual loss functions which try and make things look aesthetically closer to something, right? Now, different loss functions are going to have different effects. They'll be trying out all these different loss functions. They might even use adversarial loss functions, which are these adversarial networks that Rob Miles talked about, right? There's loads of different ways to train these, and how you do that is going to influence the actual result you get, right? Because it's not always going to work perfectly. So there's kind of two unanswered questions here. I mean, firstly, does this work, right? And the answer to, for my, personally, I don't know because I haven't tried this, right? But I think the results vary, right? That's certainly true. But also, how do we train this neural network, right? Because what you don't want to have happen, right? This is like the fake unlocking the phone thing. What was it? Unlocking your face with your phone? If you want to unlock a face with your phone, you don't want users to have to do this, right? This is something for Nvidia to do if they're going to, you know, sell this and make money off this technology. And that's exactly what happens. Sometime shortly before games release, the game developers will send an early copy to Nvidia, and Nvidia will start generating training data and train a neural network to do this process. So take an image that isn't quite as nice, it's got aliasing, it's lower resolution, and perform this upsampling, smart upsampling, up to 4K anti-aliased, right? That's the idea. And they do this by generating essentially a perfect representation of the game using 64 samples per pixel anti-aliasing. Right, so that is for every pixel, they do 64 samples from that pixel instead of just one. Really nice, 64 times slower than normal. And then they take that as their output, and the input is just a raw frame with no anti-aliasing at all, maybe lower resolution. And they train this network to take the raw frame and output the 64 samples per pixel, really nice frame. Right? And so really what it comes down to is whether in practice this works. Right? And the answer I think is probably some of the time yes, some of the time no. This is true of most deep learning, right? People don't tend to say this as much as they should, but you know, will it generalize? If you take 10 million frames of Battlefield 5 and train this network on them to get as close to this output as possible, and then you generate the 10 million from warmth, 10 million from warmth? The next frame, right? If you generate the next frame, will it have as good a performance on that unseen frame? And the answer is usually pretty good, but it won't ever be perfect, right? Especially if you're going from 1080p to 4K. So I think Nvidia have kind of made the point here that actually this is about when you're running at the very top end of your graphics card's capability. And so in some sense, they're not talking about people who are barely struggling to run the game at 1080p. You should already be able to run the game at 4K, and then maybe this will make it look slightly nicer. There's kind of two ways of doing this. One is you take a 4K input and you use this to perform anti-aliasing. And the other is you take a low resolution input and you use this to perform both anti-aliasing and upsampling. Right. And that's a harder job to do, because if you imagine that you've got a 1080p source, then what actually you're gonna have is a series of pixels like this, and you've got to come up with all of these pixels in between, right? And this is just like increasing the size of an image, enhance, right? You know, will it work? I don't know. It's gonna be better than bicubic upsampling, right? Because it's gonna be bearing in mind this local area. It's gonna say, well, look, there's an edge coming down here, so this needs to be sharper, this doesn't need to be as sharp, things like this. But this is not an easy problem to solve. And you know, by NVIDIA's own admission, this is an ongoing process. They continually train these networks on a supercomputer, and then you know, hopefully they get better and better. We shall see, right? One thing I think is quite interesting is that it means that essentially a deep network is part of your game experience on your GPU. And so the weights for this network, the parameters of this network, are actually gonna be shipped out with drivers, which I think is quite neat, right? So you're no longer just getting graphics drivers which have performance optimizations for games, and of course the hardware control software. You've also got just network weights being shipped around, right? They're quite big. So, you know, and so that's why you get limited support for games early on, because they're training these, maybe they haven't got an early copy of the game. Right. So it's down to NVIDIA to just take these games, render these super high resolution 64 times amazing scenes, and train these networks.
Strikes me that even if it's been trained, running a network, a deep network, is not computationally cheap though. Is it worth it, I suppose? What's the trade-off?
So I mean, I guess that's the question people are asking at the moment, right? So the trade-off is, so the nice thing about a neural network is it takes the exact same amount of time every time, right? On these tensor cores, there is a fixed amount of time it takes to take an image of a certain resolution and output this image of another resolution, some amount of milliseconds. Right? So that is, per frame, a fixed load that's gonna have happen. Games aren't really a fixed load. They take different amounts of time depending on what's in the scene. And the argument basically is, if your graphics card is struggling, you can drop from 4K to 1080p for a massive increase in performance, and then decrease the performance slightly by tacking this neural network on the end, right? But your overall performance will be better for it. That's the idea. So if you can already run at 4K, right, at 60 frames a second, there's very little reason to add this on, right? Which is why sometimes it gets disabled in the options, right? Your computer is already fine running this game. Dropping down to 1080p is only gonna make your experience worse. Don't bother doing it. I guess the question is, how does this network actually look, right? And it's something called an autoencoder, or I would call just an encoder decoder, right? I talked about these before, but you have an image coming in, you have some amount of network which is going to perform downsampling, right? It's going to make the image smaller, but it's also going to learn interesting things about that image as it does it. So this image is going to get downsampled through some network layers down to about half resolution, right? Something like that. And then it's going to get upsampled back to 4K or whatever the resolution of the output is, like this. Now, it's quite typical in these kind of networks to go much further than this, right, normally. So a network I use to do something like this would go down to a few pixels wide, because I'm using it to segment objects. And so this network won't learn where all the people are, because it doesn't go deep enough, right? But it will learn on a local level, kind of what's going on. This is a dark edge here, this is a light bit, there's a bit of sunlight coming in, you know, and it can start to piece some of these things together and work out in a slightly smart way what these pixels are gonna be doing, right? The other nice thing about this being only a few layers followed by quite a high resolution image, followed by a few layers, this is gonna be quite fast. Right. I mean, let's not underestimate how much computation this involves, right? If this is 1080p or 4K, quite a staggering amount of maths has to happen very, very quickly. But that's exactly what these tensor cores are for. They perform extremely fast 4x4 matrix multiplications and additions, which is exactly what this generalizes into. So you essentially pass over the image performing these matrix multiplications over these layers, and it happens really, really fast. We're gonna see more and more of this kind of stuff. So yes, this is one way of doing it. It's used in rendering for denoising of ray tracing in you know, big movies like Pixar movies and things. It's used in upsampling on TVs. Using a shallow but powerful deep network to try and tidy up something that's not perfect, this is gonna happen a lot, right? We've already seen these GANs, these generative adversarial networks turning up that are trying to produce new people's faces and things, right? This is a big deal at the moment, and there's going to be a lot of it. So, you know, NVIDIA have started this process, but we're going to see more and more, and I'd imagine it will become a kind of standard approach, you know, in a few years' time.
It is staggering that this is happening 60 times a second.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the school should buy me one of these cards and we'll give it a thorough test.
We just need to test it, don't we?
We just need to test it on, you know, all these games. So copies of these games too, please. copies of the games, a machine to run them on, one of these graphics cards, and I'll do a very thorough, in-depth research on it. But probably a similar word was in the dictionary and it got manipulated in some way, some letters got swapped around and suddenly it was cracked. We've had some luck, we've done a bit of brute force, we've done a basic dictionary attack with a few rules just to mix it up, and we've got some passwords. So far I've cracked I think about 1,700 passwords out of about 6,500.